Hi everyone, Harry here. Welcome to Scrap Science. Quite a while ago, I was having a look through the sciencemadness forum and I stumbled across a post from a few years ago detailing a very interesting electrochemical synthesis. Now, this synthesis, put forward by a user named WGTR in 2016, involves the electrochemical or electrolytic oxidation of ammonia into the nitrate ion. Now, this is super interesting because nitrates are known as being kind of hard to synthesize at relatively mild conditions. Most of the main methods of generating nitrates involve super high temperatures. Off the top of my head, there's the Birkeland-Ide process, which uses a really high power electric spark in order to convert atmospheric nitrogen and oxygen into nitrogen dioxide, which you can then bubble into water to form nitric acid, and you can get nitrates that way. You need a pretty high power, high voltage power supply for that, so that's a little bit difficult to do. There's also the Ostwald process, which oxidizes ammonia gas on a platinum catalyst surface at really high temperatures, with oxygen obviously to oxidize it, and that'll convert ammonia into nitrogen dioxide once again. That one's also a little tricky because you need pretty high temperatures for the platinum catalyst in order to get the reaction to work, and you need to perform the reaction in the gas phase in a quartz apparatus so that it can handle the high temperatures. It's definitely doable. Both the Ostwald process and the Birkeland-Ide process have both been done in a home setting before. It's not overly difficult, but I'm always on the lookout for things that are much more accessible. This electrolytic process can be performed close to room temperature without any really exotic reagents, so much more accessible. Since this reaction has been tried before and the successful results have been posted on Science Madness, we are going to just blatantly copy that work, except since we're doing science, it's not called copying, it's just reproducing results. We're going to see if we can do the reaction for ourselves, basically. So anyway, our electrolysis just involves electrolyzing a solution of ammonia. We made ammonia in a previous video. Under the right conditions on the anode, it will oxidize the ammonia into nitrate somehow. Those right conditions that I'm talking about are a little bit more involved. We need to perform the electrolysis in a basic solution. We're going to do our electrolysis in potassium hydroxide, which we also made in a previous video, because that will give us potassium nitrate, which is relatively easy to crystallize out of solution. Additionally, we are going to need to perform our electrolysis with a diaphragm, so we're going to need to separate the electrodes in order to prevent the nitrate formed on the anode from reacting on the cathode and just being reduced back to ammonia again. We also need to hold the cell at around 0 Celsius in order to stop any side reactions from destroying our product. And then finally, in the anode compartment of the cell, we are going to need a dissolved copper catalyst in the form of tetraamine copper, which we're going to make from this copper carbonate, which I made in a previous video a very long time ago when I didn't really know much about chemistry. This is actually what I do with all of my copper waste. I convert it into the copper carbonate form and I store it. Today it's going to come in handy in generating our copper catalyst, so that's good. The thing we're going to be using as a diaphragm for this process is just going to be a regular piece of printer paper. This will pretty effectively separate the anode and cathode. I would be using a clay pot, but we're doing this reaction on a pretty small scale and I don't actually have a clay pot small enough. Paper is known to work, so we're just going to go with that. All we're going to do is just wedge this piece of paper in between two of these plastic cups. You can see I've put a few small holes in them so that current can pass through our piece of paper. Inside the cup will be our cathode compartment, and outside the cup in our bottom of a milk bottle will be the anode compartment. So I'll put the cell together and then we will get to preparing our reagents. And there we go. You can see I've set everything up. I have this big plastic container to hold everything, including our ice, which should last the 24 hours that we plan to run the cell. In our cell, you can see I've got a copper cathode inside our plastic cups, and then our mild steel wire anode, which will serve to oxidize our ammonia into nitrate. And here we have, ready to go, a few hundred milliliters of potassium hydroxide solution, 2 molar, and around 20 milliliters of 20% ammonia. The exact amounts of everything don't really matter because we're doing electrochemistry and it's just going to work anyway. But last step before we add anything to the cell, we need to add around a gram, maybe even less, of our copper carbonate to our ammonia to generate our catalyst. You can see instantly we get some reaction, and then with stirring, everything should dissolve. The last thing is we fill our cell with the potassium hydroxide solution. Both chambers, both the anode and cathode chambers, will be filled with this solution. And now with potassium hydroxide added to both chambers, I will add our ammonia plus tetraamine copper to the anode compartment. And now with electrolysis commenced at around a fifth of an amp, constant current, we can have a look in here and we can see the cathode is bubbling hydrogen as we expect. You can see the solution here is a tiny little bit blue because a tiny little bit of our copper catalyst has traversed through our diaphragm. We could fix that with a better diaphragm, but this is simple enough and it should work. The most important result we see now that electrolysis has started is that despite the fact that our cathode is bubbling quite a bit, our anode, our mild steel anode, you can see is not really bubbling all that much at all. If we were just electrolyzing water and potassium hydroxide, we would expect to see a whole bunch of oxygen bubbles on the anode, but since we can't see that, we know that some other oxidation reaction is taking place. Hopefully that is the oxidation of ammonia to nitrate. And that's that. Now that the cell is set up and going, we should just be able to leave that for 24 hours. And there's really not much else to say about it. I would explain the chemistry behind oxidizing ammonia to nitrate, but I don't really understand the mechanism behind the anodic oxidation of ammonia. I believe it's a topic that's still being researched today, so I'm not going to pretend to understand it and explain it to you. So we'll go ahead and skip forward 24 hours to when we've finished running the cell, and then we will hopefully be able to extract our nitrate yield if we have one. Okay, 24 hours on, we can see the cell is still running quite nicely. If we get a look at the anode, we can see that it really hasn't fallen apart at all. If we get a look at our cathode, we can also see that that's done quite well. It's darkened in color a fair bit because a bunch of copper has plated onto it from our copper catalyst that we added. The only other things to note are all of our ice has now melted. That happened around half an hour ago, so our water bath is still cold. But I think that means it's a good time to stop the cell now from generating nitrate. Hopefully we've generated nearly a gram, but we will see. Anyway, now that the cell has finished, I will empty the catholyte and analyte into two separate containers, and then we will get on to trying to extract the nitrate from the anode compartment. Okay, membrane. It was holding together fine until I tried to remove it from the cell. It seems to have done its job okay, so we won't worry about that. Our anode looks fine. The mild steel has not corroded at all, except for the bit that was outside the solution, which makes sense. The cathode seems to be doing fine as well. So electrodes are fine. We have our catholyte here. It's only a little bit blue, and we don't really have all that much of it because the cathode compartment was quite small. Our analyte is a lot bluer, has a whole bunch more copper hydroxide suspended in it, and hopefully contains all of our nitrates. So we will now move on to the next step of extracting those nitrates. So our first step with the anode solution is to boil it down so that it's easier to work with. So we get that started on the hot plate, and in the middle of boiling it down, I realize I've made a pretty big error with this synthesis. That is the fact that I've done this on a really large scale. I have 400 milliliters of solution here, and in solution I have approximately 40 grams of potassium hydroxide. Now, since I'm expecting only around 1 gram or so of potassium nitrate, it's going to be really hard to separate this out from the rest of the anode liquor. I do try my best to get everything separated out, maybe get some nitrate crystallizing after we boil it down, but all we end up getting is potassium carbonate, which has appeared due to carbon dioxide in the air reacting with potassium hydroxide in solution. So I accept that I can't separate out any potassium nitrate product, and we move on. The only real option here is to completely start again. So I get some new ice, I set up a new cell with a much smaller volume and a much smaller cathode compartment, which you can see I've made out of a small plastic tube. We set up the cell to run with approximately 40 to 50 milliliters of solution rather than 400 milliliters, and we only add around 3 grams of potassium hydroxide rather than a full 40 grams. We run the cell exactly the same way that we did previously, and then finally, here we are after that whole fiasco. This is the anode compartment from the cell, and it's actually looking a lot more like what I expected it to look. There's a bunch of iron oxide all through the solution because the anode has oxidized a little, but that's to be expected. Additionally, the solution is pretty much clear with a little bit of precipitated copper hydroxide in the bottom. So with this solution, it should be a whole lot easier to extract any nitrate we've actually made. So we'll go ahead and do that. First thing to do is filter and then boil it down a little. And there it is, filtered. It's a little yellow, but that's okay. There's clearly a lot less copper in solution here than there was in the previous batch, so that's also a good sign. We will now get straight into boiling this 40 milliliters down to a much smaller volume in preparation of crystallizing the nitrate. I think 10 milliliters is a good volume for trying to crystallize out our potassium nitrate, so we'll have a go with that right now. Alrighty, I have left the solution to crystallize overnight, and excitingly, we have actually got a small amount of product, and you can see if you look closely the needly shape of these crystals, which is very indicative of the fact that they are potassium nitrate. So I think I will try to separate the crystallized product that we have already, and then we will attempt to crystallize the rest of it out, because there's still a little bit left in our 10 milliliters of solution that I would like to try to remove. And there we are, that is our product. It is around 400 milligrams of potassium nitrate, or we assume it's potassium nitrate, we haven't tested it yet. You might think that's a bad yield, but it's not absolutely terrible. It represents close to a 20% yield based on how much electricity we pass through the cell. Anyway, before we move on, I think, yeah, we should definitely test it so that we're not just getting our hopes up. So to test for nitrate, what I have here is a small amount of copper. You can kind of see it in there, in a really small amount of dilute sulfuric acid. And if I add some of our crude potassium nitrate, we should actually see that the copper will react with the solution if nitrate is present. Yep, if you look closely, that copper is definitely reacting with the solution. So that is definitely a positive test for nitrate, and it definitely smells like nitrogen dioxide. So I'm going to take that as a definite confirmation that what we have here is potassium nitrate. So there we are, a tiny amount of potassium nitrate made from ammonia using electricity at ambient temperatures. This is pretty cool, I think, and it actually worked. Now obviously there's a lot of work to do before this method can actually be used for large quantity nitrate production, but this is a good start, definitely. And I don't really think the reaction would be too hard to scale up. Obviously my previous attempt with the 400 milliliter scale didn't work out, but I'm pretty sure it wouldn't be too hard to make that work with a bit more ammonia and a bit less potassium hydroxide. Anyway, optimizing the process is definitely a topic for a future video. I will try my best to revisit the topic at some stage and try to make larger quantities of potassium nitrate, but for now, this is just a proof of concept, and I think it's worked out quite well. Very exciting. Anyway, I'm actually really happy that this has worked, because I was honestly not expecting the reaction of producing nitrate from ammonia to work out for us in the end, but here we are. I'm pleasantly surprised. So ending the video on a good note, I'll see you later.